whether you take new technologies like artificial intelligence or new business models, new platforms, aggregations, everything. So wearables, VR. So and yet there are huge challenges in getting to consumers, getting consumers to adopt, and getting consumers to pay, working with the healthcare, established healthcare systems. And that's where I'd like Uma Shankar to come in and share his experience of trying to work with the health systems to make what is obviously a useful service, but how do you reach people and make it a monetizable, viable business?
That's a great question. One thing I can say is that when I started my journey in the emergency space, I started as a useful service that I can do to people. What I discovered very soon into this journey is that if you look at emergency space, let's take medical science, about 42 specialties are there, gynecology, pediatrics, etc. Now, all these specialties are delivered by hospital. So what the hospital would like to see is the relationship between them and the consumer. So they will actually promote an Apollo app, a Manipal app, a Continental app, etc. That will be their way of engaging the consumer. Now, when it comes to emergency space, no hospital has a footprint. The largest hospital chain is Apollo, which has about 28, 29 hospitals. So emergency transcends a hospital. So that is one insightful understanding I had, which makes me believe that an app like Call Ambulance can actually transcend a hospital case. Number two, an emergency can happen to anybody. And four health segments we target: pediatrics, gynec, cardiac, and neuro. Which is also includes asthma, but essentially these are the four or five specialties target. In these areas, our retention of the app is about 60%. In the medical, distinguishing between healthcare versus medical, fitness, My Fitness Pal, we call them as healthcare apps. Whereas when you look at the medical space, there's no other app that comes to close to that kind of retention space. And what we are answering is basically a very psychological human fear concept, that an emergency can happen to anybody and can happen to me or my family member. And so I need to have this app. So basically, once I can sell that business case to a consumer, then I can actually engage the consumer in a journey of their health issue. It could be, I'll give an example how we're using it. Suppose there's a newborn, 20-day-old newborn. If the newborn is not able to fix the eyes on the patient, on the mother, then we can tell the mother, look, take the newborn to hospital. All such, we can do targeted push once we have a consumer having a healthcare app. So that is what we feel that emergency as a use case can solve, which other use cases will not be able to solve. That's number one. Number two, from a hospital vantage point, 70% of the money they make is a surgical or procedures. These 70% of surgical procedures that they make, 70% of that is an emergency-driven use case. Like somebody has an appendicitis, they go into the hospital. Somebody has some acute problem, they go into the hospital as an emergency case. Truly electives are only 30%. So hospital sees a reason to be a partner with us because it's both a service opportunity for service-oriented hospitals, and it's a money-making opportunity for a lot of commercial hospitals as well. So that is the reason that hospitals are willing to come on board. So basically, in this emergency use case, we are solving an ecosystem problem where the alignment to solve this problem is very, very high. So we're hoping that we can pull off this at a global level because the problem is globally applicable, going far beyond India as well.
So to reframe the same question for Care Motto, you, in a way, you're part of the existing system because you're working within the hospital system. Now, it's fairly common knowledge that hospitals have practices in place to maximize their revenue. So patients sometimes are, you know, advised surgical procedures which they may not need, or expensive diagnosis they may not need, etc. Because, I mean, it's a business. So how does your model, which is promising consumers a fair deal, work within such a system? How do you overcome this basic conflict? Because you have to work with the hospitals and you have to serve the interests of consumers.
Okay, so what we did is with our friends and then the information we gathered, who are like basically doing fair practices, like in whichever hospital they're delivering good treatment at right cost. So we identified about 80 of them. And then we have partnered with 25 of them, only 25 of them with, like, you know, I know these people personally. I know a lot of surgeons personally who have operated with them. These people are like, you know, these people, they follow several protocols. They use good quality instruments, these good quality antibiotics and all these things. These things will bring down the cost actually. Just say for example, somebody follows, a surgeon follows a typical protocol in doing, just say for example, knee replacement surgery. They do it in 10 steps. If they do those 10 steps, the number of days the patient stays in the hospital, number of days in the ICU, the recovery becomes faster, rehabilitation becomes faster. So we identified those people and we started telling these patients that these are the five people whom we can trust you with. So we are referring these patients there. So these hospitals, they started receiving good volumes from us. So it's a volume game again. They're bringing down the prices for these people. They're having better treatment. I mean, as soon as they go to the hospital, are you insurance? Are you self-pay patient? No, sir, we are from Care Moto. They have extra, you know, the kind of experience they have is a lot different. And that is one. And second thing, like, you know, I myself, like, you know, when my, when I need somebody, just say for example, a pulmonologist, if somebody asks me for a pulmonologist in my family, I'll have to call up some friend of mine and then, you know, some general physician to pulmonologist, I'll inquire the name, take a contact, put in a word and then send my people there. So I have an access into healthcare community or doctor's community, but what if somebody from Vijayawada or, you know, from Guntur or from Mehboobnagar comes to Hyderabad and then they're looking for the right doctor and right hospital. That's where Care Moto comes in and gives them the right information and we help them get there. Not only paid patients, but some people with Arogya Shri, Arogya Bhadrata, all these popular schemes. And these people also, like, you know, these days, no private hospital, they are doing the that kind of treatment. So we refer them to MNJ Cancer Institute or Nizam's Institute of Medical Sciences. There are instances where I answered this call, I've admitted this patient in NIMS, since I'm a practitioner at NIMS, and I operated on the same patient, which is under Arogya Shri. So which is possible, that way the right information for the patient can bring down the price and then reduce the inpatient time and then the money saved can be used for rehabilitation.
The integrated model. While the others have been also trying to put this across, the key differentiator is that the journey starting from doctor consultation reaching
Practo
to
Practo is highly integrated, right? I mean, they have everything from hospitals to doctors to everything on the platform. Yeah. But I don't know if they're making money from that or from their SaaS product.
No, they're certainly raising funds, so that's for sure. But so the big difference is the comfort of your home. Everything that comes at your doorsteps. That's the big differentiator. If you see Practo, you'll have to actually drive all the way, still stand in the queue, because we also know that unlike
So in that case, why don't you focus on that? I mean, if home delivery is your big differentiator, why aren't you focused on that?
That's where the focus is. All our services, if you see, all the ones that I named and the ones I didn't name, doctor consultation, drugs delivery, diagnostics, medical facilitation, hospitalization assistance, health insurance. So it's that you'll have to be, like the pilot said, set bat, relax. The doctor will come to your home, the services will come to your home, will take care of you at the comfort of your home. And if the case may be that you need special assistance in reaching out to the hospital, like he said that, you know, most of the times the customer is not sure how much he has to pay for the surgery, we will have our associate hospital network where we'll make sure that you get the best price for your knee surgery or the occasional surgery that you want.
So the customer is paying for your services, or where do you make your money?
Customer will pay for the services for sure, but obviously to capture the entire market, affordability is a big thing for us. We really want to pick and price the services below the market price. That's a must have, because if you want to capture the entire market, that's a must have.
So maybe a word from you on the business model, on the money, because it. I mean, do you make money from the hospitals or do you make money from the consumers? On both sides, it is difficult. So maybe a word about the difficulties as well.
Yeah, a good point. How do I make money, right? So basically, today I do a transaction fee. So for every ambulance trip, I charge a transaction 50 rupees. So similarly, when a consumer goes to hospital, I again charge a transaction fee of 50 rupees. I don't take any percentages. It's like today in the market, a lot of players operate at referral fee of 10%, 12% kind of referral fee. I don't operate on that. I only do a transaction. Now, I'm in active conversation with a lot of insurance companies. The insurance companies have a vested interest in getting a consumer very quickly into hospital because it will lower their claim experience because treatment can start early, etc. If they can come into play, and they will come into play, surely.
Are they responsive to this?
Extremely responsive. Very, very supportive. They want my platform to cross a certain threshold before they can invest into it. I have commitment from two insurance companies to support me from April 1st. So we're doing some back-end integration. So we are taking two supports from the insurance companies. One is that they need to pay directly to the ambulance, and therefore, in a way, I'm getting the payment from the insurance, which is a representative of consumer. So my loyalties to consumer can be even more higher. Number two, there is straight-through processing, which means that if an insurance player in certain insurance policies, they can allow you a straight-through processing where you go to hospital, all the checks are done, and no more administrative hassles in terms of asking you questions. So that will be done in real time. So that whole process takes away a good 45 minutes, 1 hour of wait time, which a lot of hospitals experience today.
So, a word about the money and also about scaling up, because I mean, CareMoto, you started with, you know, with your knowledge and connections.
Yeah.
How do you scale the, I mean, do you want to scale up or keep it as a smaller, medium business?
We are definitely planning to scale, but the thing is, again, the major catch is identifying the right players in every city wherever we go. That's going to be one big challenge, definitely. And initially, our plan was to charge hospitals something called a business auxiliary charge or something, depending upon the type of the amount of business what they have received. But slowly, what we have come to is now we have reduced the number of hospitals from 90 to 15. Only 15 hospitals we are planning to sell, planning to send our, refer our patients to because of the obvious factors. Now we are planning to charge the patients as well. Till now, patient used to go free, unless until it is going to be a second consultation from experts, which we have six of them on board, where they can send us reports and then we give them a good opinion whether to go for the surgery or not. There we used to charge them for second opinions. But primarily, if they call our call center or use our tech platform, they just have to register, they get the right information. So basically, we are probably a pivot there. We'll be pivoting a little bit there. And then, and what was the second question about? Yeah, scaling is definitely is going to be a little difficult, but I have friends like, I worked in Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Andhra Pradesh, so I think I can manage South India. Let's see, I'll cross the bridge as it comes.
So on call health, one of the, health is something that we are all like, very, very scared about. I don't mind an e-commerce delivery at home, but healthcare delivery at home, I'd be, really thinking twice about. So how do you overcome that? And I also have seen on your website that you have a problem in accessing a sufficient number of health givers to make home calls. So how do you overcome that? You've said that you're going to train people to do it. Is that something that would be allowed under the current regulations? What kind of care would you be able to give at home with that kind of
That's a very valid question also. In healthcare, it is all about experience. All the hospitals who have gained the name, it's the experience that they've given, reducing the number of deaths, and that's the confidence that they've given to the patient that you come to the hospital, you will take care of you. Likewise, here at Call Health, it is also about providing the same delightful experience to all customers every time. It's like setting up an assembly line. Every product that comes out, the quality parameters have to be same. It should be like Domino's, where every pizza that you see and eat in any part of the country will have the same size, dimension and taste. And the reason behind that has been our practice and deep research. Our pilot testing went up to 18 months in Hyderabad itself, where we serviced numerous number of customers, and we believe in train the trainer model, where we believe that all our employees in the first step, initially we went with asset heavy model, and now we are turning into asset light model, where all the resources that we have trained, we have experienced, have set up benchmarks, have experienced problems and customer expectations. Now that whole resource set is ready to sort of train the market. Hyderabad was a pilot test, and now if you see it, all the cities where we're launching rapidly are utilizing the learnings and that five-star service excellence experience that we have sort of done in past 18, 20 months. That is translating into service excellence as we go ahead.
Just a last word on, I mean, healthcare is a space which has enormous social implications, so the government comes into the picture. Obviously, I mean, you're dealing with mostly private hospitals, so that aspect we've discussed. But is there something that a proactive government like Andhra can do to help, you know, because clearly there is a problem in building sustainable businesses, although the potential of tech in healthcare is enormous. But to realize that potential, you'd probably need some kind of a push. What would that be from the government?
Actually, this is a very active conversations going on with three states for me. I don't name the states because we have not signed the deal yet. But I can speak definitely to Telangana government having helped us integrate with 108. And they are also launching a pilot program with one hospital in Hyderabad where we get to actually educate these four specialties, pregnancy, pediatrics, cardio and asthma. We want to target those patients and get them enabled on emergency handling. The second area where we got enormous support from government is building a first responder network. So we train a lot of, we do logistics, and the doctors in emergency department of 60 hospitals I networked with, they actually train people on first response, like how to give a CPR, how to stop blood loss to happen, etc. Now, this training program, government has extended a lot of help for us. So, which means that we'll be able to reach out to government institutions and train a lot more people on the aspect of emergency care. The last point I want to make is education. Currently, government spends a lot of money, and across the globe, that's been the trend, that they spend a lot of money on mass media to educate people about, let's say, simple things like eating iron tablets for pregnancy, for improving the iron content in the blood. Things like that, they do a lot of mass education. Now, across the globe, people have been moving into digital social media spend for the marketing. So that is a space where we will actually excel outstandingly well, because the four specialties I've identified, pregnancy, pediatric, cardiac, and asthma, all four of them actually are tied into United Nations Millennium Development Goals. So not only are we aligned with the government, we are aligned with WHO as well. So there is a monitoring agency and funding agency that is actually looking to push this social content onto people's phones. So we are very, very ideally placed to become that content education partner to the government. And the same thing we are extending to hospitals with their own doctors becoming the face of that content education to their own consumers. So the content education is where we see I'm not joking, about $2 to $3 billion revenue across the globe as a possibility. That's a huge market space in terms of targeting consumer, educating them on their pointed need.
Well, Indian health problems are really different from the West. When you compare it, compare our problems, be it disease-wise, be it who is spending for healthcare, because more than 65% of our country are uninsured. And a lot of them are, like, you know, obviously the 65% are out of pocket spenders. So what's happening is more than 8 million families every year, they are becoming bankrupt because of healthcare related expenses. So there are two things which we need. We don't have a one-off silver bullet, so we need two things for India as far as healthcare is concerned. One, affordable healthcare. Not many people can afford these kind of treatments, so government has to bring in probably Arogya Shri or a new scheme which is happening in Vijayawada. Tata has implemented some healthcare scheme in Vijayawada, some kind of those things which can help these affordable the healthcare for those people. And second thing, we'll have to insure everybody, insure all the citizens of this country, because not more than 3% of GDP in India is being spent for healthcare, whereas US is spending 14.5% for their we are 1/4 of their population, and our GDP is only less than that. In spite of that, we are spending only 4% of that. So the government is spending very less on healthcare. And third thing, We are all happy that by 2030, more than 60% of India are going to be youngsters. Now, the chronic disease burden is the highest in India. If you see diabetics, they're starting at 30. 24, 25, we see heart attacks setting in early. And hypertension. Recently, a friend of mine, they did a survey in a gaming company, 35 employees. They took blood pressure for all the 35 employees. 28 of them, they are suffering from hypertension. All are smokers, alcoholics, youngsters, type A people doing beautiful things in gaming, but health is being neglected. So affordable healthcare and preventive healthcare. Almost all the diseases are preventable, and cancer is one of the highest in India. By 2020, WHO says like one in every 8 women runs a risk of breast cancer. So early detection
these are general health issues that the government has to deal with. Thing is, how can the government be more proactive in giving a push to the use of tech and startups in the healthcare space?
That's exactly. Concentrate more on preventive healthcare rather than, be it Care Motor. It's only a discovery platform, right? You're finding the right doctor. But who is helping them to prevent these diseases? Probably some app for breast self-examination, helping them prevent breast cancer. You know, somebody, basically one-stop shop or one app to help them prevent at least 30 to 40 common diseases, monitor them, and then give them the inferences. Just say, for example, today Fitbit says your heart rate is 84, and today you took only 3,000 steps. What next? Why is my heart rate 84? What should I do with that? What is the significance of that? Then if I start walking or jogging, my heart rate is going to come down, my resting heart rate. Then it has to tell that, your resting heart rate is coming down, you are definitely becoming healthy. Now you do this, like that kind of preventive healthcare, proactively preventive healthcare has to come in. Because we can't afford, healthcare is seriously expensive, we don't have insurance, government is not spending enough money, but somebody has to come in to help the treatment. It's patients' money. Whatever said and done, end of the day, healthcare or medical care is a service industry at heart, but somebody has to pay the money, right? So government can help in insuring people, one, and second thing, bringing down the cost of drugs and medical equipment, that is two. And third thing, improvising on the public, improvise the government hospitals. Every government hospital, they have facilities, but who is using it? Instead of paying, this is my opinion, I could be wrong, but paying private hospitals for these kind of treatments, you invest in the infrastructure of government hospitals, bring in all the equipment, employ more doctors, and give them all the things to do it. But these days, both the states' governments are taking up now. We did 6 liver transplants in Nizam's Institute under Arogya Shri. Government is paying 14 lakhs for liver transplant. So is the case with other governments. So that kind of schemes have to come in to make healthcare affordable by everybody. And even then, it is not very sustainable. Insurance is the way out, and preventive healthcare is the best in the long run.
Yeah, so I'll quickly summarize this also. And a very important point here, I think all these healthcare startups, technology-enabled healthcare startups especially, are a blessing for state governments and the country in general also. Why? Because the big data that they promise to provide in the future can be actually path-breaking, especially for a country like India, like Niranjan said, that one of the lowest insurance rate. Uma would know that, the difference between difference of that 15 minutes when you reach to the hospital, when you make them reach to the hospital, if the hospital has direct access to your past health record, that could be game changer for somebody who could, be suffering from a death. Similarly, there are so many issues, healthcare issues, where India still ranks higher, prenatal deaths, birth rate, cardiac deaths and all. And primary reason is lack of data. So the more healthcare startups that would come in the market and provide that affordability to the patient, and in a way capturing a lot of informative data and utilizing that in presenting and giving to the public agencies, to hospitals also moving forward, that can be the game changer.
When we built a Carlo Ambulance platform, everything is owned by the consumer. And the consumer can choose who to share the data with. And for some reason, the consumer feels that he or she does not want to share data with their own family members, or for that matter, hospitals. They can just knock it off and take it off. And this is extremely critical. I was just sharing with somebody else also that the younger generation wants me to enable a Facebook login or a Gmail login, and I don't do it on a platform. I insist on a separate login for ourselves, because the social angle to data share has a different spectrum of privacy, and we don't want to get into the privacy angle at all. So we are very, very serious about data, and I would presume most others also are, but we have taken steps to segregate personal identifiable data with the medical data, and the storage and the architecture behind it actually exceeds a lot of the HIPAA rules that United States mandates.
And we are still in the nascent stage. Like, you know, we don't have proper mechanisms to capture the data. From now on, probably, first of all, we should rescue the data, store it, and then probably run analytics however you want on a later date. But right now, what we have is a lot of case sheets in still hard copy format, and then it requires a lot of money to digitize all that data. And second thing is, we should encourage people to become data donors, to, you know, bring in the data and then, you know, run analytics and probably, you know, arrive at conclusions to prevent a lot of diseases. For example, we still follow the Western standards of body mass index, which is not which doesn't hold good for Indians. We have a different this thing. Our BMI is supposed to be much lower than the our Western counterparts. So there are so many things that way. All the medical instruments are calibrated to their standards. All the dosages, everything is first. That's the reason why we should rescue all the data, whatever we generate from now on, and then probably run analytics probably later. That's how.
So I believe healthcare industry right now is like your pre-startup environment, like 15 years back, maybe in India, where there were no startups, and then when startups came. You know, you started having all the amalgamations and acquisitions and all. So we rightly mentioned that there is hardly any data to play around with. And now when you see, when you have so many e-commerce platforms, there are aggregators. So once you start building the data, I think obviously government will also find some more responsibility to aggregate those data. You have got UID, Aadhaar now. So maybe the future of that would be, once you have enough amount of data available, then government agencies will start pitching in. And build up a platform with the help of private organizations to make a fruitful meaning of that data.
Probably there's a lot of data is being concealed, but whatever little data we have, we are still the highest, one of the highest in the world. So data has to come in, somebody has to pool in the data, and then probably work on the steps where we can bring it down, you know.